What's happening, my Jacked family? Coach Scott here, JackedAfter40.com, and this is probably the most important video that I have ever recorded on this channel. Testosterone is a hormone that typically comes up in conversations about men over 40, and although we'll be talking about testosterone today, what I really want to talk to you about is a hormone that I had not heard of at all up until just recently when I received a huge wake-up call that caused me to make some major lifestyle changes. I'll be sharing those lifestyle changes later in this video, so be sure to watch it all the way to the end. Here on the Jacked Up to 40 channel, I pride myself on keeping it real, on being open, honest, and sharing behind the scenes footage of what goes on in my life. And today I'm gonna be getting more personal than ever before, and quite frankly, sharing stuff that I'm not the most comfortable sharing. So if you appreciate this level of transparency, please hit that thumbs up button, I'd really appreciate it. First off, it's important to give you a bit of background information beginning 3 years ago when I first got my hormones checked, why I got them checked, what the results were, and why I've spent the past 3 years thinking that a lot of the issues I've been facing were in my head. That is until just recently when I got my male hormones checked by using a home kit from Let's Get Checked, which found really high levels of a hormone that my family doctor didn't test for 3 years ago. I'm incredibly grateful for the thorough work done over at the Let's Get Checked labs, and grateful that they are sponsoring this video and offering a 20% discount to the subscribers of the Jacked After 40 channel when you go through the link that I include down below in the description and enter the promotion code SCOTT20. So let's go back to early 2017 when I was 41 years old, and this was the time when I first started experiencing symptoms that were often associated with low testosterone. I had low energy, I was tired all the time, experienced a lot of brain fog, and there were a couple times where I experienced low libido. I was still waking up most mornings with an erection, so I figured my testosterone had to be okay, but I wanted to be certain, and it was enough of a wake-up call where I was like, you know what, I should probably get myself checked out. So I made an appointment with a doctor, and February 9th is when I went and got some blood work done and got my male hormones checked. My testosterone was measured at 18.1, and based on the labs that my doctor uses, their normal scale is between 8.4 and 28.8, so I am right in the middle there. And if you want to convert that to a number that you may be more familiar with, it comes to 522 NG over DL. My free testosterone was measured at 204. The normal range is 196 to 636, so I was borderline low free testosterone, but still within the normal range. Free testosterone is often referred to as bioavailable testosterone because it is the testosterone that's easily used by your body. So although your normal, like your total testosterone may be within the normal range, if a lot of your testosterone can't be easily used by your body, it can have some negative consequences. You can experience some of the symptoms that I've referred to as the brain fog, the low energy, the fatigue, and lower libido. So because my total testosterone and free testosterone were both within the normal ranges, my doctor said I checked out fine and offered to write me a prescription for Cialis to help deal with the lower libido. But because it happens so infrequent, I didn't bother with that. So I left the office thinking I was fine, and maybe some of it was in my head. I figured a lot of it had to do with the fact that I was unhappy in my marriage, and shortly after this, I did end up getting a divorce. My plan was to get retested at least once a year to compare my results, but I never seemed to be able to make the time to get retested. During the past 3 years, I've experienced the odd occurrence of low libido. Once again, it didn't happen very often, and I was still waking up most mornings with a hard erection, but I still couldn't help but wonder what was wrong with me, especially when my testosterone had tested in the normal range. And in recent months, I found myself waking up in the middle of the night soaked in sweat. I knew something was up, and it had been weighing on me, so I knew I had to get in contact with my doctor and get my blood work rechecked. And it was at this time when Let's Get Checked reached out to me and said they'd like to sponsor a video and send me a male hormone test kit to use myself and see how it works. This was definitely the convenience I had been looking for, especially considering that I had put off getting retested for nearly 3 years. So I did a little research and found that the Let's Get Checked labs are CLIA approved and CAP accredited, which is the highest rankings level of accreditation that you can get, which gave me confidence in their services and encouraged me to give them a try. The male hormone test kit arrived in the mail and included an alcohol swab to clean my finger before pricking it with the needle, included 4 needles, just in case you need more, which I did, and a vial to capture your blood sample, a package to seal your sample in afterwards and protect it, and then a paid postage envelope to send your package off to the labs to get your results processed. At the time I was about to do the test, I had a little bit of a head cold, so I sent an email off to Let's Get Checked to see if this would interfere with my results at all. Within an hour, I actually got a phone call from one of the nurses at Let's Get Checked who reassured me that it wouldn't have an impact on my results. I thought it was really great customer service to get that kind of response right away and that kind of reassurance. They recommend taking your sample early in the morning before 9 a.m. on an empty stomach, and they also recommend doing it earlier in the week, preferably before a Wednesday, so when you ship it off, it gets to their labs before the weekend. In their instructions, they recommend which finger is often best to prick and where to prick it on that finger, as well as other options afterwards. First prick didn't work, couldn't get any blood from it. Pricked that same finger on the other side, still couldn't get any blood from it. I actually passed out. Like, here's something about me you may not know. I have a fear of needles, a pretty strong fear of needles. And every time I give blood, I basically pass out. Except that last time, I was so proud of myself the last time I gave blood for that last hormone test 3 years ago, I didn't pass out. But each time, like, I tell them when I go into the office, I typically pass out. So they have me lying down on a bed. The nurse was just really good the last time I was there, really talked me through it, had me laughing, kind of distracted me enough where I was able to get through it without passing out. But I typically pass out when I give blood. So even the finger pricks here, it was enough to, it's all in my head. And I did pass out after those first 2 pricks. And so I had my girlfriend at the time drawing the blood for me, and I ran my hand under warm water once again. I did that the first time. They do recommend it. They do recommend standing up, but of course, me being afraid of needles, afraid of getting my blood taken, I needed to be in a lying down position. So it's probably optimal to be standing up. But warming your hands gets the blood circulating in there. So running your hands under warm water gets that blood circulating. So I did that again and pricked the middle finger this time, and boom, it was a steady flow of blood, like no problem at all. Got all that sample right away and quick. So I guess that's the reason why they give you the 4 needles there. So if it doesn't work 3 attempts, chances are by the 4th attempt, you are gonna get blood on one of those, a good sample from one of those spots. So got that blood sample, sealed it up, used the other alcohol swab to clean my hand up, my finger up, and then rushed it over to the UPS store, got it shipped in the mail, and awaited my test results. When your test results are ready, you get a call from a Let's Get Checked nurse to go over those results with you. My testosterone came back at 21.1, which converts to 608. I was ecstatic because that is higher than where it was 3 years ago. Not significantly higher, but still, to see an increase was a good thing. It could very well be just the difference in labs. One may be a little bit more accurate than another. It could also be that in the months leading up to this test, when I started experiencing some of the lower libido, I increased my vitamin D3 to 4,000 IUs, and I also started taking 3,000 milligrams of maca. So maybe that had a difference. Maybe it's the 2 labs. I'm not so sure. So once again, my total testosterone was right in the middle of the normal range, maybe just a little bit higher than last time, but still very consistent with where I was 3 years ago. And the free testosterone was still borderline low, so still within the normal range, as you see in the free androgen index here, in the normal range, but very close to the lower end of that range. So very similar. Total testosterone and free testosterone are pretty much the same as what they were 3 years ago. Now let's get to those things that weren't tested for 3 years ago and were tested in this Let's Get Checked Male Hormone Home Kit, beginning with sex hormone binding globulin, SHBG. As you can see here, my levels are above normal, and that isn't good. As we talked about before, free testosterone is the testosterone that is easily used by your body. Testosterone binds to sex hormone binding globulin. Whatever testosterone isn't binding to your sex hormone, SHBG, is your free testosterone. So the more SHBG that you have in your system, the less free testosterone you have. So you want to get that SHBG in that normal range so you have more testosterone that's easily used by your body. As you can see, my estrogen levels were within the normal range, and then the huge wake-up call, my prolactin levels were nearly double the high end of the normal range. High prolactin levels can cause a lot of the same symptoms as low testosterone and can actually lower your testosterone. So now let's explore possible reasons why my SHBG and prolactin levels are high and what I can do to lower them. During the consult with the nurse, she mentioned that high levels of SHBG and prolactin are often associated with high levels of stress and lack of sleep, which totally made sense. During the past 3 years, I've gone through a divorce. A little over a year ago, there were big changes in my business that were stressful at the time, but also gave birth to Jacked After 40, which is the best thing that has ever happened to me. And then leading up to getting this test done, I was having thoughts of breaking up with my girlfriend, who is an amazing person, and I struggled with the idea that I was going to hurt her. And although I like to think that I was managing my stress pretty well, there were definitely times where I was dwelling on some of the negative things that were causing these stresses in my life. In the months leading up to this test, I was in bed for 8 hours, pretty much my normal routine, but my sleep was very interrupted. I was waking up frequently throughout the night, hot sweats, and thoughts running through my mind, although I was able to calm them down pretty quickly and get back to sleep fairly quick, but it was like frequently waking up in the middle of the night. And although I was in bed for 8 hours, I probably didn't have the best pre-bed routine. I'd watch TV right up until the moment I'd go to bed, and oftentimes on social media right up until I went to bed, which can both have a negative impact on the quality of your sleep. The nurse over at Let's Get Checked told me to get in touch with my doctor and go over these results with him, and she suggested that it may be helpful to supplement with vitamin B6 and vitamin E, but to go over that with my family doctor to see if that would be the right choice for me. One of the concerns about high prolactin levels is that it could be a benign tumor that is pushing up against the pituitary. It sounds like it's something that's fairly common and easily treatable, something that I'll definitely have to consult with my doctor, definitely get some more blood work done to see if some of these changes that I'm about to make are going to have a positive impact and bring my levels down, or if we need to book an MRI to see if there is a tumor in there and something that we have to do about it. Other possible reasons for high levels of SHBG and prolactin are anorexia and overtraining, which is oftentimes while you hear competitive bodybuilders experiencing these symptoms of low testosterone, actually getting low testosterone, is because they're going through extended periods of dieting, and oftentimes they are overtraining. They're doing a hell of a lot of weight training. They're doing a hell of a lot of cardio. So that can have a negative impact on your prolactin and SHBG. For myself, I did just come off a 4-week mini cut, but it was just 4 weeks and it wasn't a very aggressive diet. For the past 3 years, I've been at maintenance or in a gentle surplus. So basically been in muscle building mode. So I don't think diet had anything to do with this. And the 3 weeks leading up to this test, I was already up to maintenance level calories. When it comes to training, I train 5 days a week. I walk my dog. There's no other cardio. Yes, I live an active lifestyle, but it's not excessively active. During the Christmas holidays a few months ago, I took 2 weeks off. During the summer, I took 3 weeks off, and I periodize my training volume. So I go through low volume phases where I allow my body to fully recover, the fatigue to dissipate. I'm doing all the right things with diet and nutrition. For myself, I don't think that's related to this issue. I do think it's probably most likely a lot to do with what the nurse said, stress and sleep. So we're gonna get to how I'm gonna make some improvements to my overall lifestyle here to see if that has a positive impact, and hopefully I don't have to get an MRI, and hopefully it's not a benign tumor that's pushing up against pituitary. I'm feeling I'm gonna be good. So up to this point, I've been doing all of the right things. I'm at a healthy body weight. I eat well. I don't typically drink very much alcohol. I drink caffeine, I wouldn't say excessive amounts, although I was starting to drink a lot of diet pops. I was drinking a lot of Coke Zero, which has a lot of caffeine in it. So maybe I was consuming a bit more caffeine, which can have an impact on these levels. So the first major lifestyle change I've made is making sleep priority. priority number one. Yes, I was in bed for 8 hours, but now I'm doing everything I can to get at least that 8 hours and make sure it is quality sleep. So I've got a solid bedtime routine where after 7, at the latest 7:30, no freaking electronics, no social media, no television. I do some self-massage, some foam rolling, read a book. If it's nice out, I'll go outside, I'll watch the sunset, do everything I can to calm myself down. When I get into bed, I make sure I get into bed a half hour before I want to fall asleep, and I listen to a meditation audio, which allows me to let go of my thoughts for the day. As a business owner, with everything going on in my life, it's easy for my brain to go 24/7. That was a big part of my issue before. So this meditation audio allows me to get rid of all of those thoughts, let it go, and focus on what is most important to me in that moment, and that is a great night's sleep. So that whole thing, that whole bedtime routine, has improved the quality of my sleep big time. And this is a consistent sleep-wake schedule. Weekdays, weeknights, it doesn't matter. I'm in bed at the same time, waking up right around the same time, and I wake up without an alarm because it is so consistent now. It's been automatic. I don't need an alarm to wake me up in the morning. I wake up feeling refreshed, energized, invigorated, and ready to dominate the day. And that was not happening before. So I can't emphasize how important a quality sleep-wake schedule is, and bedtime routine. If I need to, if I have a lot of thoughts going on in my mind, I will do a brain dump. I'll dump all my thoughts on paper, and oftentimes I'll write out my to-do list for the next day, because oftentimes I would find myself in the past going to bed and thinking about all the things that need to get done tomorrow. I write it all out. I know what needs to get done tomorrow, so I no longer have to think about it when I'm in bed and should just be focusing on sleep. Getting out for 2 daily walks with my dog is something I have been doing for years and using it as a form of stress management. But what I realized is that a lot of these times during my walks, I'd be thinking about all the things that I needed to get done. And I couldn't wait to get back home so I could get back to work and do things. And admittedly, there were times where I would dwell on some of the negativity that had been going on in my life. So the major lifestyle change around these daily walks is that now I am more grounded in the moment, with a heightened sense of awareness for all the sights, smells, sounds going on around me, just really paying attention to the beauty, nature all around me. And this is when getting out for a daily walk truly is an incredible stress relief. No thoughts about business, no thoughts about negativity. It's just soaking up my surroundings and truly being grateful for this very moment. It's a great way to start my day when I go for my morning walk, and then winding down at the end of the day, it's a great way to calm myself down and finish my day with a sense of gratitude. So when you hear me harping about the importance of stress management and sleep for men over 40, this is why. For supplementation, I'll talk to my family doctor about incorporating vitamin B6 and vitamin E. I am going to add ashwagandha. I heard that is very good for stress management. Supplements I'm already taking, like I said, vitamin D3. I'm taking 4,000 IUs of that. I think I'm going to bump it to 5,000 IUs. I'm going to continue taking maca, the 3,000 milligrams of that. I'm taking 300 milligrams of magnesia. I've been doing that for a long time, and taking 2 triple strength capsules of fish oil, which works out to be, I think, like 2 grams of the fish oil there. That's about it for my supplementation other than creatine monohydrate and whey protein powder. In regards to nutrition, I'm going to increase my veggie intake, especially broccoli and cauliflower. Those have been shown to be very helpful for men and healthy testosterone levels, as well as lowering prolactin. Alcohol, I don't consume much alcohol, but I'm gonna really make sure I keep that in check. Caffeine, I have eliminated most of the that pop intake, the Coke Zero or Pepsi Max. I've almost completely eliminated that. It's less frequent than it was before. I just had my 2 cups of coffee in the morning. Before, I was consuming 2 to 4 cups of coffee plus the pop. So definitely I have experienced a decrease in caffeine intake. I'm gonna try to decrease my sugar intake as well. Again, it's not too bad, but just something I'm gonna be aware of. Like I said, my diet overall is pretty darn good, but hopefully these subtle changes, can't go wrong with adding more veggies in your diet, bottom line anyway, for overall health and well-being. So I'm looking forward to increasing increasing that and decreasing the caffeine intake more than anything. And I've gotta say, just from a short period of time making these major lifestyle changes, I am already noticing a difference. I can feel my libido increasing. It's basically every morning waking up with a hard erection. So with my libido high, it's a great thing. I can feel improvement. It's also not such a great thing being now a single bro in self-isolation with a higher libido. Maybe I didn't quite time this right, but it will be good to come out of this feeling my absolute best. So my plan is to get rechecked with Let's Get Checked in a few months, as well as making an appointment with my family doctor to get blood work through him and consult with him. I actually had an appointment, I think it was the beginning of April, to go through that. So my blood work done here with Let's Get Checked, the results came back beginning of March. Right away, made an appointment with my family doctor to get a physical, get some blood work, and then this whole lockdown happened and I couldn't get in to see him. So I'm looking forward to this to be lifted so I can get into my doctor, get my blood work done, consult with him, see where I can go from here, and then get rechecked again in a few months. Actually, I'm hoping by the time I get in to see him, it'd be nice to get blood work done through him and hopefully see that my prolactin levels and SHBG are lower at that time. Maybe even free testosterone up a little bit higher would be great as well. So that's where I'm at right now. I'm really looking forward to seeing how these lifestyle changes make improvements to my overall levels and then go from there. See if I do need to get an MRI or anything like that. So the big take home message from this video for men over 40 is to not only get your testosterone levels checked, but make sure you are testing for prolactin and SHBG as well. If you want to use the same home kit I did, visit Let's Get Checked down below, and don't forget to use the coupon code SCOTT20 to save yourself 20%. I do get a commission from this if you go through my link. I want to be clear on that, but I hope that you realize that I'm not recommending Let's Get Checked just because of the commission. I am recommending it because if it wasn't for them, I would not have known that my prolactin levels are high. I would not have known that my SHBG is high. I wasn't getting that kind of information from my family doctor. I didn't know to ask for it from my family doctor as well. Prolactin is not something I had heard of until I got this test done. And man, was it a huge wake-up call. Here I've been going the whole 3 years thinking, what is wrong with me? My testosterone levels are in the normal range. How come I'm experiencing these episodes of low libido at times? How come I'm feeling tired? Although, like the past 3 years, 3 years ago, I was definitely tired, fatigued, low energy. Not so much anymore now. More lately, it's just been the lower libido at times, on occasion, rare occasion, that kind of had me thinking, like, what's going on? How come this is happening for me right now? This just doesn't feel normal. I don't want to feel like that. I want to be feeling my freaking best all the time. I want to be performing my best all the time. So this was a huge wake-up call for me. This is why I am recommending Let's Get Checked. I had a great experience with them. Even though I hate needles, I pass out when I get my blood work done. This was quick, convenient, and just, it was just a great overall experience. From the phone call right from the beginning when I had the cold and was asking them questions through email and they called me right away, that impressed me. And then the consultation right afterwards and everything, it's just the whole process from beginning to end was great. Really enjoyed it. But either way, get your testosterone checked, get your prolactin levels checked, SHBG, estrogen levels, all this stuff. Make sure you are taking care of your health and being proactive with your health. Don't be like me and put it off for 3 years. Don't come up with an excuse to avoid getting yourself tested here. Get it done now and get it done frequently so you know where you're at. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please hit that like button. I'd really appreciate it. If you want to see more videos like this, be sure to subscribe to the channel and hit that alert button so you're notified each time I upload a video. More than anything, I would love to hear from you down in the comment section below. Share your insights, share your thoughts, share your feedback with me. And before you go, don't forget to download your free guide, Jacked After 40. Hope you have yourself an absolutely amazing day. I'll catch you in the next video.